Clients send inquiries to the server. That's standard so far. And what the server does is it eventually uses the plugin APIs, one of them, to call one of these types of plugins that exist inside the server binary. It does that to basically be able to execute the SQL queries. Whenever it's needed, the service is needed, then you get it. That's not working. Okay. So to make things more complex, we also get to add another binaries to the mix. So these plugins can be living not only inside the server binary premises, but they can also be living in external binaries that the server loads and unloads as needed. And they still use the same APIs. So you have here plugin A and here plugin A API again. So these are practically equal to the server. They just reside in different binaries. So this is how the big picture looks like. And to top it off, we also have what we call a MySQL plugin service, a bunch of them actually, that the plugins can call. Because as you can see, the plugin APIs go in one way. They go out of the server to the plugins. And the services API, they go in the other way. They go from the plugins to the server. So this is how the server provides infrastructure and services to the plugins so that they can execute their job and be good citizens of the MySQL server binary and process. Okay, so now, and also please feel free to interrupt if you have any questions at any time. I would be happy to answer them again. So the life cycle of a plugin. We have the initialization, of course, and this is triggered by one of those, either install plugin or the server startup. And the server startup can load plugins in one of those two ways, either through the command line or if they are stored into this system table. We also have the moment where the server actually uses the plugins, and it does that by doing API calls. And this results in server events, which are, well, mostly query execution, and that's how the plugin APIs get called. And finally, we have the uninitialization phase, which is basically the uninstall plugin, the server shutting down, or the user session ending. So user session ending is a bit unusual because, well, you would expect that the plugin would be unloaded in one of those two occasions. But some of the plugins, they have a bit of a different life cycle. So they can wait for all the active sessions that are using them to end. And that's why there is this extra trigger here. Okay, so what plugin types does the server support? Obviously, if the server is going to call the plugins, it is important that you know what kind of calls the server is going to make to these plugins. We'll start with the simplest one. So these are the daemon plugins. And they are very simple because there is no plugin API whatsoever. It's just initialization and deinitialization. So what can we use these plugins for? We can use them for doing stuff on server startup and shutdown. Because remember, they get initialized when the server starts. So they get the control, and you can do stuff there. We can also use them to spawn daemon threads. So if you want to do your own listening thread, if you want to listen to another socket on some other protocol or whatever, and then do something inside the MySQL server like that when you get an event through this other means, then you can start a daemon thread, and that can then call plugin services inside the server. So you will end up with yet another, like a client session, but that's completely internal. So that's how you can use the daemon plugin. And the limitations are that there are no APIs to call. Obviously, server will not call you. So, can anybody hear me like that? Yes. Okay. I will just speak louder. Okay, so there are no APIs to call. The server will basically not call your client. So you need to account for that and arrange for that to get the control. Okay, I'll still speak there. Okay. The next type of plugins, by complexity I should say, are the information schema plugins. So information schema in MySQL, for those of you that are not aware of what this is, it is a bunch of pseudo tables that are not stored. And they are used to display tabular information out to the SQL session. So that's obviously you can create a plugin that creates one such table. So this is what the information schema plugins are. And it is called when somebody does select from that table, because again, it's a virtual table. So it needs to be filled in whenever it's needed. It does not exist in any persistent state or form. So that's when you use information schema plugins. For example, if you have like a configuration information or a status information or something like that, and you need to provide it to the SQL user, then you use an information schema plugin type. There are certain kinds of limitations. As I mentioned, it is an ephemeral table. So it is constructed when needed, and it can be quite often. So basically, your server may end up filling that table over and over and over and over again. And that takes resources. That takes CPU. That takes memory. And also, there is not a lot of query condition pushdown. So imagine you have, like, I don't know, 10 million rows that you would like to present of the status of your plugin. And imagine the application only needs 4 of them. Because of this relatively poor condition pushdown, you may end up materializing all of the 10 million rows just to let the SQL layer extract the 4 that it needs. And that, again, is, well, a bit of a resource waste. And also, it's only one table per plugin. That's another limitation. So if you need 2, you need to create 2 plugins. It's a bit odd. Fortunately, you can fit more plugins into a single binary, so that's not such a big of a deal. But you still need, you will end up with a lot of rows in the MySQL plugin tables if you do that. So be aware of that limitation. Okay, these are my favorite because I've helped written them a lot. These are the authentication plugins. So we use those plugins to verify account credentials. In MySQL, there is no standard way to authenticate a user. None whatsoever. It's all plugins, basically. So it's a plugin pair that decides how the user will authenticate. And that's what these authentication plugins are. Basically, the API is very, very simple. It just takes a... Well, basically takes the credentials that are supplied by the client so far and then gives you a yes-no answer. The API is very, very simple to implement. So I encourage you to try this if you want to hook into enterprise directories or somehow manipulate the user access. Because obviously these are run when a user authenticates. So you can take over and basically control how this is done. And we have a lot of examples with that plugin type because they are so easy to write. People are kind of keen on writing them. There are a lot of authentication plugins. And kind of the major limitation that I see is that there is no session context yet. So you can not call all of the plugin services that the server provides. Because, well, obviously, it does not know yet which the user is, what kind of rights does it have, and all of that. So it is a bit problematic, but if you know that this is the case, then it's all good. Okay, so this is our, the audit plugins are our Swiss Army knife type of plugin. Basically, it is a very, very, very rich API. It is originally designed to allow writing auditing plugins. Basically, you get all of your events and you decide how to audit them or not. That's why it is a very rich API. Basically, it's called on server start, it's called on query start and end, it's called on session start and end, and also all kinds of events locked into the slow lock or the error lock. Basically, you get constant notifications. You get like the water hose, pretty much. And of course, we have a plugin that takes all that and writes it into a file, and that's how, well, auditing is done. But you can use it for a lot of other things. Basically, in 5.7 that I mentioned in earlier, all these APIs return a Boolean, continue or stop. So you can basically control the execution of the query on all of these stages that you get control here. And basically, it pretty much allows you to affect the running of the queries in any intimate detail of it, pretty much. Of course, the volume is high. So you need to be aware and do pre-filtering, because otherwise you will basically slow your server to a crawl. It's very, very many events that this plugin API gets. So, well, if you do a lot of processing on each of them, then the server will be extremely slow. Okay. So this is the one that you want to experiment with if you want to do something non-trivial with the MySQL server. So for example, we did a firewall based on that. And it's a very powerful API. The limitations are that you can basically go into infinite recursion, because some of the services that are provided by the server to the plugins can result in another audit event. And then you can end up in a loop, basically, just calling yourself continuously. So, well, you need to be careful about that. Also, the references to the plugin are cached. So unloading one such plugin is not easy. Basically, the plugin can be unloaded only after all of the sessions, all of the active sessions that are using it terminate. That's when it gets unloaded. So this is one example of the type of plugin that unloads itself at session end. So that's kind of peculiar about the audit plugins. Okay, this one is much simpler. It serves a very specific purpose. It serves to enforce a password policy inside the MySQL server. So again, this is a 5.7 thing. And what it does is it gets the control whenever a new user password is set for a user account, for any of the user accounts that have their passwords hosted inside the MySQL server. Or you can call it explicitly. We have a function that an SQL function that basically is used to evaluate the strength of a password. It gives you like a percentage sign from 0 to 100. And that's when this plugin gets called again, and it needs to provide this numeric value. Basically, it takes the password string and returns a percentage sign of strength. So you can use that function to display like nice bar graphs in your UIs when you set passwords. We also provide a default implementation for that plugin type that enforces a certain password policy. But since it is a plugin, basically you feel free to provide your own password policy through implementing one. Okay, so limitations are currently that there is no backing store provided. We thought long and hard whether we should provide some sort of a backing store so that it detects that you've reused your password and says, no, that's not good. We don't currently have that, so you will need to organize your own. And we don't have it because we have all this diversity of passwords. So it is kind of hard to know whether it is okay to store that password or not. And that's why we decided to leave it to the plugin authors. There is a way to store them, either in a file or in the database itself, but you need to cater for it. The API will not give you that. So that's kind of the current limitation that we have. Okay, and these are the types of plugins that MySQL is probably best known for. You can abstract away a whole table, like, well, a whole database table. So obviously, this API is called when the server needs to manipulate the table at all, in any way. And it can also be called explicitly through the handler SQL interface. We have like a step interface, like open the table, read a row, skip a row, so on. And obviously, it is really good for implementing different backing storages. So if you want your tables to be virtual and reside in another server, you use a table, a storage engine plugin to basically, tell the MySQL server that it needs to read and write data from this other server. Or if you want to somehow store it in a LDAP directory or whatever. Basically, as long as you can construct a tabular representation of your data, you can use the storage engine plugin to, let the server use it, basically. And all of the tables in MySQL are manipulated by a couple of such plugins, most notably the InnoDB and the MyISAM. And obviously, you can do a lot of things with the table. So this API is really complex. Last I checked, it had more than 200 methods that you need to implement. So that's a lot. And, that's the price you pay for it being so powerful, of course. Okay, we call these the small plugin types. Basically, these are like a plumbing type of thingy. We have the full text parser plugin, API, which is not very popular because, apparently the syntax that we do for full text is kind of enough for the people using it. So nobody really, I know, implemented one of those. We also have the replication and group replication API. These are used mostly for internal plumbing because the replication now is pretty much a plugin inside the MySQL server. And we have a specialized plugin types to support it. It probably is possible to implement another replication type, but probably it's even more complex than the storage engine. So, check them if you need them. They are there, but I not really know how this works. And finally, our legacy here, the UDF plugin. This is still not implemented, and it hasn't been since probably 4.1. I don't know. So we have a plugin type, but nobody generates events for it, and there is no API defined. It's a bit odd. Okay, this basically covers the plugin APIs that we have inside the 5.7 server. Some of them are new to 5.7, some of them are old. And I want to talk a bit about the plugin linkage types. So this is a bit different. So far we've been talking about APIs, i.e. how you call your plugins from the server. Now we will talk on where these plugins, the code for these plugins, can physically reside. So that's the difference. Okay, so obviously, as you've seen on the big picture, we start with the internal plugins. These internal plugins, I have some examples here, like the MyISAM storage engine and the InnoDB storage engine. These are the plugins that we cannot live without. So basically, the system tables, most of them are either in MyISAM or in InnoDB. So you need those two plugins in order to operate the MySQL server. And obviously, you need to be able to at least somehow authenticate users. So you need an authentication plugin, at least one. And they are statically linked into the server. So basically, they are an integral part of the server code. They still use the plugin API, but they are completely internal. No, nothing external or loadable there. And obviously, since they are part of the server and they are released with any server binary that you ever, well, put out or compile, they can basically not really respect the API and do backdoors and all of that. So basically call into the server code. The next level of isolation that we have are something that we call static plugins. So basically one example of those is the SHA 256 authentication plugin. It's not strictly speaking required. I mean, if you use it, of course, you will need it. But the server can basically start without it. So that's why it is in a different group. And these are, again, statically linked into the server binary, but that we do purely for availability reasons. We want to make sure that you have these plugins without the extra hassle of loading them when your server starts. And they can also be added dynamically into the plugin or the storage subdirectories in a source repository. So you get the source repository, you create your own little directory inside it, and then you just invoke the make process, and the server automatically picks up your plugins from these directories and binds them inside the server code. So you don't need to change the server code, you can add your own, and they will still get linked inside the server and initialized and all of that. Okay, and the ABI compatibility again is a bit optional. It's good to have it because you can decide later that you want to make this a dynamic plugin and distribute it separately. But since you are linking it with the server, you might just as well kind of get the benefits and call internal APIs if you want to do that. Okay, and the final type of plugin that I have are the dynamic plugins. Those are, well, I have some examples here. Most of the plugins that we distribute as part of our enterprise version are like that. This is the audit plugin. This is the Windows native authentication plugin. We have a PAM authentication plugin. Stuff like that. So basically, these are again required only when you use them. If you install them, obviously you will need them, but otherwise, no. The server can again live without them. And these are separate binaries. So this is what differentiates them from the previous types of plugins. They can live in a separate binary and can be dynamically loaded into the server. Again, you can compile them, but you only need the binary distribution. The binary distribution comes with the relevant set of header files for you to use to be compiling one of those plugins. So you don't need the source anymore, the source distribution. That's a step forward in a way. And obviously, the ABI compatibility is highly required, highly recommended. Because if you build something and you change the server version, like upgrade your server, your plugin may stop working if it's using one of these internal APIs. So basically, you need to make sure that your plugin is upgrade safe by using the published APIs only. Of course, MySQL being open source, you can still, well, basically look at the source and decide if you want to call something else. But, well, it makes life easier for the DBA if you don't, if you can afford not to. Okay. Right. And finally, we have the plugin services. I kept mentioning them so far, but I will try to give them more attention now. So plugin services are basically what the plugins use to call into the server code. So if you need something from the server and you want to reuse some of the server's code, that's how you do that. You call plugin services. They can obviously, for that particular reason, be only part of the server code. They cannot be added dynamically, at least currently. So you need to basically be building them inside the server code and either compile your own server or contribute them to one of the, well, supporters, forks of MySQL, if you like, or to the MySQL itself. That's us, basically. We have a lot of services that we provide inside the server, so it's constantly growing. We add them as we need them, pretty much. Or if we have a good idea, we add it there. And what the service represents is basically it's a C structure with a bunch of function pointers inside it. That's provided by the plugin, by each individual plugin. And then when the plugin is loaded, the server basically fills in these addresses of all these functions, because it also knows about them, so that the plugin can call them. And that's how you ensure that your plugin is API compatible. Basically, if you only use these functions, then it's all good, because the server will give them to you. And no matter if they changed places or are called somehow differently or whatever. Okay, so that's plugin services. They reside, by the way, into the include MySQL directory. That's where all the headers are. And am I still in the way? Sorry. They start with the service underscore. So all the headers that start with the service underscore are the services file. Of course, they are part of the documentation too. So most of them are documented in the reference menu. You can take them from there too, but if you need the headers, that's where they are. Okay, so speaking about finding source code, where can you find examples to copy from? That's the most common way to start developing a plugin. You take a plugin that does approximately what you need, you gut it out, and you put your own stuff into it. So that's pretty much the development cycle, even internally. We do that because there is a non-trivial amount of boilerplate code. There is a lot of plugin declarations, structures that you need to fill in, global arrays, global variables, all of that. And obviously, if you have a plugin to start with, all of that is done for you, so you don't need to redo it again. And that's where you can find the plugins that we have, in the plugin subdirectory and in the storage subdirectory. Subdirectories of that top-level directory in the source code are basically all of the plugins that we have inside the server. Some of the internal ones are not there. They are scattered throughout the source code, but they still use the same boilerplate code, this part here. So you can search for them by name. If you do show plugins, it will show you all of the plugins. And then if you grab for that name, you will eventually end up with the plugin definition. Okay, and of course, since we are responsible developers and we do regression testing a lot for everything we do, you can basically reuse the tests that we do as examples. So all of the plugins, they have certain kind of testing code that gets them through their paces, and you can see how they are used by inspecting the test code here. It's mostly SQL, so it shouldn't be that hard anyway. Okay, so notable examples to start you from. The Audit Now plugin, I really like this one. It basically implements the full auditing API and does nothing with it. It just, well, throws away the data. Of course, you can just add something to it, and then, well, you will be having an audit plugin. That's the daemon example plugin is the other kind of common starting ground. So you have the full daemon boilerplate code, and it does a few things, but they are not that interesting. So you can just throw them away and reuse it to make yourself a daemon plugin. We also have an example storage engine, and we also have something that we call the black hole storage engine. It does the same. It pretends to be a storage engine, but just throws away the data. And Federated is another example that may be close to you. Basically, it talks to a remote server. So that's That's what we have. And quickly, this is where you read further. The reference manual, this really good book by two esteemed colleagues of mine, and you can hit the forums or Google. So that's how you find out more. Okay, that's pretty much all I have to tell. Any questions, anybody? Yes, sir.
I have wrote a few plugins for MySQL, and my problem is that I cannot write a query analyzer plugin that stores all the information in the MySQL schema. Is there a situation where a plugin can create his own virtual tables in the MySQL schema and have them persistent there and not recreate them every time?
Okay, so if you want to be storing data into these tables, then you need to do basically upgrade to 5.7. We have a service, a plugin service, like a bunch of them, that allows you to open up a client session. When you do that, it's fully virtual. It's not linked to any external TCP/IP connection or whatever, and then you can just execute SQL through it. Basically, create the session and then start sending SQL and receiving the result internally programmatically. So basically, you can just execute create table pretty much. Okay. Other questions?
Do we have a question?
Hello. Do you think that you are creating a repository for MySQL plugins, maybe something like Perl CPAN modules or PHP modules, your own repository? We know that everyone can use GitHub, but do you make a collection of all MySQL plugins?
Okay, it would be obvious to make, but we don't really do it for perception reasons. Basically, once you put them in this repository, people will kind of start expecting that you would also going to support them.
Questions? Okay, no more. Thank you.